Sustainability is a blanket term that simply means to be able to sustain the state of something for as long as possible, to sustain. We're still finding ways of incorporating mindful processes, but in a product-focused industry like fashion, what sustainability might mean is the ethical and transparent, deliberate sourcing of raw material, the humane and dignified treatment of the people involved in the process, the life of the actual product once it's in the hands of the consumer, and then the afterlife. What I explore through my work is designing the approach to a product, constantly asking questions like, what are my raw materials? Where are they being sourced from? What product am I designing? What role does the consumer have to play? My name is Soumya, and I design handbags, footwear, and small leather goods. Simply started as my material exploration project one summer when I was spending time in India in my grandma's home. Her home was being renovated, and there were a lot of wooden planks just lying around, ready to be discarded. It was old window panes, doors, drawers, leftovers from new stuff that was being made. And I wanted to incorporate some form of carpentry or furniture design techniques in my work. I wanted to see the hard wood next to a soft fabric. So the bags are made in jute and they have wooden accents. Jute was sourced from Kolkata, where you have ideal conditions for harvesting it. It doesn't use as much water and is a pretty easy to maintain crop. The main applications of jute are pretty durable, like sacks for rice, wheat, potatoes. I played with the contrast between the rigid wood and the soft jute. Become was another material experiment. I was fascinated by electroplating and I wanted to see how we could deposit metal on something so soft and pliable as leather. I was in Tuscany a while ago where I visited tanneries that were vegetable tanning leather. So in order to stop the decaying process and to make a skin fit for use, you have to cure it using tannins. And the most common way of doing this is using chrome, which is a heavy metal. But in the case of vegetable tanning, extracts from tree barks are used, which makes it a totally natural process. It takes longer and it renders the leather unique properties, which I wanted to highlight. For example, the leather becomes perceptive to light. It darkens with more exposure to sunlight. You can wet mold it and it holds its shape when it's dry. It basically beautifully displays signs of wear and the passage of time.
Hi, my name is Isabel Saxton and I want to talk to you today about my thesis collection, which is called The Impossible Dream.
My impossible dream is for everyone to be sustainable by choice. Not because they feel guilt-tripped into doing it, but because they have become informed so they want to adopt a sustainable lifestyle for the rest of their time here. I am deeply inspired by finding the beauty in despair, the contrast between nature and synthetic, and most importantly, my friends and the community around me. So I worked towards inspiring them to adopt sustainability, and I've done this through humour and highlighting how absurd it is being informed about sustainability but not implementing it. I don't think that the guilt-tripping approach is sustainable long-term, because maybe you'll adopt a sustainable lifestyle for a couple of months, but you don't really know why you're doing it other than the fact that your friend said that you're a horrible person if you keep using single-use plastic. In order to change your lifestyle, you need to have the knowledge that can inform a paradigm shift. So this is what I want to achieve with The Impossible Dream. It's designed to be worn by every gender, day and night, so that we can come together to make an informed community that can stand out for sustainability while pioneering solutions for the future of our planet. My bright, bold, and slightly obnoxious aesthetic comes from finding used construction wear at a scrap store and noticing the irony of construction workers wearing the most attention-grabbing things on the street. Yet when a passerby sees them, they look the other way and pay them no attention. This same irony is happening with sustainability, which is why The Impossible Dream's fabric, thread, and hardware are from secondhand sources or are organic. I aimed to assign secondhand fabric new value and turn it from something unwanted into something that is valuable to prevent it being disposed of. So the bulk of my fabric is from secondhand shops, thrift stores, FabScrap, which is a company in New York that goes to clothing and textile companies and collects the fabric that's being thrown out and resells it. I also went to a couple of local factories and asked them if they had any scraps or defective fabric that I could repurpose, and they were so generous, I got several yards of truly unique fabric. Patagonia also sent me some of their clothes from their Reno repair center, which couldn't be used anymore. And I found buttons and all sorts of random things just on the floor in the street. And I looked at what I already had, like my Grammy's sewing kit, which I inherited after she died a few years ago, in order to give items in that new life through my garments. The only new element of my collection is the naturally dyed organic merino wool that I use in my machine knit pieces. And the driving force behind my decision to use a new fiber is that the moment for me when my work turned from, look, this is something I made, to, look, this is something I made and I'm wearing it, was when I learned how to machine knit, because it gave me the freedom to design bold graphics I'd always dreamt of making but never did, because I knew that printing on garments just isn't environmentally responsible. But in using naturally dyed wool, I was able to make an environmentally responsible textile, since wool is biodegradable and recyclable, meaning that it naturally lasts for at least 7 generations, which makes it sustainable. My machine knit textiles quite obviously depict the ironic, humorous, and satirical aspects of my thesis through motifs and phrases. I also have educational and self-reflective elements written on it, like, it's easier not to care, and 80% of clothing goes to incinerators or landfills, which is a statistic that I found through Fashion Revolution. I call my work accidental because the shape, size, and color of the scraps of fabric that I use and find completely inform the design of my clothes.
This top, for instance, I took all of the scraps off the skirt that I made and the jumper that I made, and I sewed them together to make this top, which is why it's draped in this particular manner. Because I literally just looked in the mirror and pieced the pieces together based on whatever looked good on the body. And this happened a lot in my work.
I like to use these trousers as an example of my practice because so many elements went into them. So the main fabric is an all-weather blanket that my friend gave me because he didn't think that he was going to use it anymore. The knee pads are made from discarded scrap pieces of leather from a local factory. The pocket lining, the fly front, and the interior of the waistband are all made from silk, which I found at the Rhode Island Recycling Center for Education. And then I replaced where the elastic was supposed to go with naturally dyed organic merino knit. And then the zip is from a pair of trousers that I got from Savers, which I was using as muslin fabric. Since the heart of this collection has stringent ethical standards, I desperately wanted to show that it can go hand in hand with freedom, youth, and irreverence through the colourful and highly energetic spirit of this collection. I've channeled my frustration with the stagnant status of environmental and social responsibility to make art to attract people who want to fight for the welfare of the planet. So I'm going to leave you with a few things that you can start doing to get you rolling on your journey towards a sustainable lifestyle, just in case you haven't started yet. Reduce what you're buying, love what you have, and if you have to buy something new, seek out designers who are making a positive impact on the planet.
Hi, I'm Abby Hollis. I'm a recent graduate of the Savannah College of Art and Design, where I studied textiles and design for sustainability. Even before my time at SCAD, I was really passionate about sustainable fashion, and I knew it was something that I wanted to be involved in. But even in my own personal shopping experiences, it was something that I still struggled with from time to time. I struggled to fight the urges of fast fashion, as I'm sure we all do at times. But after my time at SCAD, once I really got into textile production and I understood more the process and I connected more with people upstream and downstream from me, that's when I really fell in love with slow fashion. And I fell in love with the stories behind textiles, not only the appearance of textiles. And that's really where my personal sustainability journey shifted, away from guilt and toward excitement and passion. And I found that that connection through storytelling was something that applied not only to me, but to people around me too. And so I wanted to create something that would amplify that connection and amplify that attitude around clothing. And that's where Thread Threads comes in.
If clothes could talk, what would they say? Some would tell of horrific labor practices. Some would tell a story void of fulfillment, unworn and underappreciated. Some would describe eternity in a landfill. But others would tell passionate stories about their designer's inspiration. They would tell uplifting stories of how craft provided opportunity. They would tell stories about their owners, a first date, a perfect interview, a life-changing conversation. And we would be drawn closer to these clothes. Thread Threads is a platform to give our clothes and the many people they've touched voice. By purchasing a threaded article of clothing, consumers gain access to a living story. When they enter the item's unique Thread Threads code into the database, they're able to see into the article's past. Here, they meet the designers, makers, and consumers that the cloth has touched. Beyond exploring a piece's past, users are able to shape its future, adding their own stories to the thread. They're able to memorialize critical life events through the clothes that they share them with. By doing so, they embed their stories into the cloth, adding value and human connection for the next buyer. By participating in this story, users grow closer to their clothes and to one another. They're motivated to support responsible brands, hold on to clothing longer, and shop secondhand. At Thread Threads, we believe every piece of cloth is a living story. We want to partner with makers, brands, first-hand buyers, and second-hand buyers to write the story of everyday cloth. At Thread Threads, we want to tell your story.
Thanks so much for joining us at Sustainable Fashion Week. Follow along to keep up with Thread Threads at MyThreadThreads on Instagram and at threadthreads.com. Thanks.
Hey, my name's Isabella, and I believe that what you wear matters. I'm a recent RISD apparel grad, and I'm here to talk to you guys today about my most recent collection. Over the summer, before I began developing my thesis collection, I took a hard look at my own wardrobe, and I thought, what am I wearing in here? And what are my favorite pieces? Which ones do I love the most and want to put on every day? And I ended up pulling out all sorts of hiking gear, things that were tinged with mud and smelled like the grass, and you know, had a huge graphic tee, an oversized graphic tee that bleach stain. And then I had some sort of designer piece that had been passed down to me from my mom or my grandmother, and it was in a dry cleaned bag, and it was pristine and, you know, hanging in the closet. And I thought the dichotomy between the two of these pieces was extremely, extremely intriguing. So I wanted to create a dynamic women's wear collection that really someone could wear, you know, hiking, to a nice dinner, to having an interview. So the dichotomy between these two genres was extremely fascinating to me. I also knew that I didn't want to use any synthetic fabric, so I limited myself to using only natural fibers, and I found actually all of these from this place called the Rhode Island Resources for Education Center, which is this marvelous place that has all sorts of donated, you know, defected product that is given to them to, you know, have a second life. So I was able to have this. I ended up buying all of my fabric from this place because a sheet factory produces nearby, and they give all of their discarded ends to the recycling center. So I ended up getting all my fabric from there, and I also was able to get thread and elastic, which I used in the collection too. This way, I was able to dye all of the pieces and really explore natural dyeing. Ended up using rust from the sculpture studios and also willow from this massive willow tree that fell down during a storm. The natural dyeing gives this rich color to it, and it adds this history to all of the pieces, which I find is just so important. I also did a collaboration with this tent company, which is based in New Hampshire, and they gave me old tents that were prototypes when they were developing their gear that they didn't need anymore, and I was able to make that green tent top out of that. So that's the only synthetic piece that's in the collection. And frankly, the industry is saturated with new brands and with brands in general. So I think what's most important is that there is a team of creators who want to ignite change in the fashion industry, because climate change is real and we need to innovate and create a circular fashion system and an economy that supports the fashion industry in a way that supports our planet.
Mexico City in 2014, and now is based here in New York. However, the manufacturing remains in Mexico. The brand is a socially responsible brand, and it's always been conscious about how the fashion industry affects our environment and our society. That's why we care about the labor behind each accessory and the materials that we use. Technology that has been used for the past years on this process of manufacturing handbags. However, for the materials, it took me a while to find a supplier that was as well like based in Mexico, so like that I could avoid like the traveling or bring the materials from another country all the way to Mexico.
We use vegan leather at the moment. We use like two different type of vegan leathers. We use vegan leather made by a factory that treats the 100% of the water and recycles 70% of the water. The factory uses natural gas, lowering 30% of the volume of carbon emission, and it uses energy produced by steam on the production of the materials. We also use other type of material that comes from cactus, the plant. So this is a very sustainable practice. As well, the factory is located in the same state where the bags are manufactured so we can keep all local and try to minimize the volume of carbon emission that we can create as a brand.
Is inspired on the desire of freedom.
Each handbag is called freedom in different languages. We have Swedish, we have Basque, we have Bosnian, we have French, of course we have Spanish. The color palette comes from a Joan Miró constellation painting, and one of the shapes that I use is a shape that not only represents the cycle of reusing, but it's also a shape that can be found on the sacred geometry of the earth. And as it's been said for researchers and writers, our entire planet contains a magical geometry.
I'm Laura Harrington. I am the one-woman show behind my brand Fly By Night NYC, and I'd love to give you a studio tour today and then also show you how to take your mask from summer, spring and summer, into autumn, because we're going to need them a little bit longer apparently. So yeah, let's do a tour. So I first of all wanted to tell you a little bit about my brand and how it happened and what it is turning into, because I feel so excited and just love what I've been doing. So Fly By Night actually started through a place where I wasn't allowed to work in the US. I used to be an art director in advertising. I absolutely loved it. I worked in London and Paris and into New York. And then through moving here, I actually came over on a non-working visa and so wasn't allowed to work. Within that period of time, I decided to put my time to as much use as possible, because I don't think there's many opportunities in life when you're not allowed to work. I had some amazing experiences from doing blind tours at the Whitney, so many different volunteering, and then learning to sew. So I took four beginner's classes, and it just stemmed this absolute love affair for fashion. Basically, I was sewing away and the lovely Chloe from the West saw my pieces and said, do you know what, do you want to see if these work? My visa had just come in. Do you want to see if you want to try these and if people would like to buy them? And I was like, yeah, let's try it. And that's kind of what happened, which is crazy. So now I'm in 7 female independent shops and 1 male hair salon, which I love. And yeah, that's the start of Fly By Night. Everything here is made in a sustainable way. So the fabrics are deadstock fabrics, designer deadstock, or they are fabric from movie sets. I've had some really, really cool fabrics come my way. So I've had movie set fabrics from The Mummy, Snow White and the Huntsman, most recently The Departed, which I love because I'm able to add that to my label, which I think is really important. And my labels actually have the hours on them, where the fabric comes from, as much as I can tell them about that fabric, just to make sure that people understand how special the item of clothing is. And actually, it would be amazing if people understood how difficult it is just to even make a simple top. Just the work, the craft, the time that goes into it. And hopefully people would start buying more slow fashion and fast fashion just from that understanding. So, on to my pieces. I create these really fun romantic pieces that are sort of puffy sleeved. Some are wrapped, some are boxy fit. I've got, this is a current piece that is something that I'm working on for my new collection, which is a double sheer organza arm, where I was really influenced by these beautiful, they're sort of 1950s little felt birds. And so I've been stitching these into the arms to show the changing of the summer and going into fall, and then, you know, all the birds swirling, and this is, they're going to be swirling around the actual arms, which I'm not sure if you can pick up on camera. This then translates all of the way that I try and make sure that when I cut my fabrics, I'm always leaving fabrics the space to do more with them. So from this, I've then been able to make the beautiful double organza little bird scarf as well. And then of course, onto my crowns, which my crowns are my big sustainable item that everybody, my customers are amazing and absolutely love. I have made these headbands, which I love to call crowns, in three different sizes. We've got the classic, midi, and large, and they're really fun. They're a take on the scrunchie, but in a headband form. These are all made from the scraps that are left over. So all of the scraps I make sure go into their different sizes of headband. Sometimes there's only one, sometimes there might be six. You know, it just depends on how far the fabric goes. And also I love to buy a fabric with the thought of buying a tiny bit more than I envisioned for that fabric. I don't tend to buy rolls of fabric. I always buy yards of these specific amounts. Sometimes the movie set fabrics can only go so far because I'm only getting what isn't used on that set. So that's where my fun pieces go. Once the pieces are too small, I pretty much buy my sewing machine. I always have my tiny, tiny pot. This is for my really, really mini pieces. You know, your tiniest cuts that I couldn't do anything with this. But if you can, you're welcome to having them. So that goes in my teeny weeny ones. I then have another bag, which sits just alongside. These are for my bigger cuts. This is for when I'm sort of cutting my larger pieces and I don't have a really big piece left over that I think, oh, do you know what? That's going to be a scarf, that's going to be a headband, I'm not sure. So then I keep this bag, which is for my in-betweeny sizes. So you're sort of looking at this sort of size. So something that's small, but still I wouldn't really want this going into the recycling quite yet. None of my fabrics would ever go in a landfill. Everything gets recycled at Fab Scrap, which is an amazing female founded company, and they recycle everything into housing insulation. It's pretty incredible. But yeah, so this in this bag goes my next pieces. Sometimes then I'll go through these and then I'll make a separate pot of things. I'll be working on a list of things, what to do. I always have a list of what could I make with these small pieces? What will I do with them? This one example has already been used to practice some embroidery on. Once I have figured out from this bag what is and what isn't usable, then I have a separate bag. I won't bore you with that bag. It's just a beast of tiny, tiny cuttings. That is the bag that will go to Fab Scrap. So that is about my pieces, basically. And now I'm going to show you how to make your mask go so... Oh, I forgot to tell you about my mask sets. So throughout COVID, basically, at the beginning of COVID, I started making masks for healthcare workers. I had to find a way to make myself useful. And so I started making them for healthcare workers, and then after that, I had a lot of customers messaging me saying, hi, can we get masks? And I was like, oh, I'm not sure yet, because I want to make enough for healthcare workers, see how, you know, the government deals with actually supplying these. Then when it got better, I decided, oh, do you know what? I will make some masks, but I want to make it my way. And the way I wanted to do it was to really help promote mask wearing. And so I created these quarantine queen sets, which are, it's actually a headband and a crown duo. And this just, I think, is just so much fun, just as a way to make it part of your fashion, make it part of your personality. I've actually recently been embroidering them with wear a damn mask, with your name, with your initials. Something fun that just makes it feel like you're not losing yourself through this. I think it's really important that fashion, you know, it can be functional and it can also be fun. So why not? But yes, I'm going to be showing you how to make this mask more autumn.
So just before I show you how to make your mask, I realised I hadn't told you about my compostable packaging. So I have to tell you about this, it's crazy. So this amazing packaging is made by No Issue, and it actually can work as plant food, which obviously, as I am heavily inspired by the beautiful outdoors, which you'll grow to learn from my designs, you'll know that I'm so excited that all of my packaging is also compostable, so even my stickers, which I absolutely love. My packaging doesn't come beautifully wrapped up in a crazy bow. It actually comes in compostable tissue, a very thin piece of thread wrapped around it, and a piece of recycled cardboard to keep the item flat. I do not want to see my packaging in 6 months. I do not want to see it in a year. I never want to see it again, and I don't want you to be keeping it as well. I believe it's all about the product and not about the packaging. So this stuff is pretty special. While I'm here as well, I just want to show you all of my beautiful threads. All of my threads are also either desktop designer or vintage. Whenever I see it, I collect it. I've got like a beautiful rainbow going on here now. So yeah, it's just another aspect that I think is really a fun way for home sewers as well. Just when you see it in a thrift shop, just grab some thread, you know? You'll be able to just fix anything, mend anything, do anything. So yeah, now on to the mask. See, I got it right. Okay, so I am going to show you how to make your little quarantine queen set, or if you just have a mask, just to make it transition into autumn or fall, as you want to say. So what I've got today is, I thought it would be really fun. I got this sort of picnicky one that was really lovely in summer, and now I'm thinking it would be a really easy one to turn with some little bit more fun colours. So what I'm thinking is these little iron-on squirrel and nuts are really, really sweet. I've been working on the placement before, and I was thinking around here, so I hope you like it as well. And then what I'm also going to do is have these lovely ribbons instead of the elastic to bring some more colours to it. This ribbon I actually found from a shop that was closing down, so it was really lovely to be able to give that some life still. So let's get started. Now with your elastic, I would say actually you could try and keep this. Try and tie it in a knot and use it as a hair tie. So I'm just cutting off the ends there. Keep that, it's a hair tie for later. Always losing them. So cut off both these edges. Another hair tie. Yes. So I want my little squirrel. I'm thinking just down here, and I'm going to have these sweet little nuts just over this side. So I'm just gonna iron on those. I was thinking you could actually also use some lovely vintage beads, would be really pretty as another idea. With the ribbon, you could also braid the ribbons. So many fun things you could do with your mask just to personalise it. Let's get that on nicely. It's very exciting working from an actual studio. I only moved from Brooklyn about 3 weeks ago, so this studio will probably change a little bit. If you follow me, you'll see a little bit of an evolution probably of what's going on around here. So Squirrel is looking cute and in place. Oh my goodness, you are so cute. This is gonna look so fun. Now, for these pieces, I wasn't gonna braid these because I actually only had another blue and I didn't think that the colors would be perfect. So just gonna stitch these either side down here. I will get on and do that. 1 second. Okay, so now once you've tied on these, you've got both of your sides looking really sweet down the side, and it's definitely feeling more the colour scheme that we want. And then I'm just gonna simply tie these in a little knot for where they probably will go, and then you'd adjust it later. And then, yeah, you've got yourself a cute, slightly different mask. I'd say like go hit up some vintage shops, maybe message some sellers online so you don't even have to go in, which would be really great. And just see what they have, see if anybody's got any vintage ribbon. I love using vintage fabrics and vintage ribbons. They're just, the quality is next level and so beautiful. But I think this is actually gonna be a really cute set. I'll put it on for you, 1 second, okay. So here is the final mask set. You probably can't hear me very well, but I think it looks really, really cute. Probably hear me now. Yes, it came out so well. I absolutely love it. Send me what you make and how you adapt to yours as well. You can follow me on flybynight.nyc on Instagram, and also my website is flybynight.nyc. So yes, I hope you enjoyed this. I probably missed out a million things, but yes, come and give me a message, send me what you also make, and yeah, I'm gonna finish this how every time a sale comes in, or with a little happy dance. Goodbye.
And what is it to work with love? It is to weave the cloth with threads drawn from your heart, even as if your beloved were to wear that cloth. It is to build a house with affection, even as if your beloved were to dwell in that house. It is to sow seeds with tenderness and reap the harvest with joy, even as if your beloved were to eat the fruit. It is to charge all things you fashion with a breath of your own spirit. Work is love made visible. Khalil Gibran on Work.
Hi, I'm Rudo Nondo, the country coordinator for Fashion Revolution Zimbabwe. And we have been walking an amazing journey during the Fashion Open Studios with our two designers, Lanai Madondo from House of Stone and Julian Tamuka from Gaililuya, as well as their collaborators, Halima from Yakasikana and Tendai Angela Rockins. We have chosen the theme fashion therapy just, you know, as a way of reconnecting with our clothes, reconnecting with the way that we use our hands and just how our clothing makes us feel. But through this experience, we've actually been delving into the different aspects of fashion as a form of shelter, that being what we've been focusing on with Nyakasikana and Julian, and then also fashion as a form of therapy, and that has come out through the meditation processes and just through the handcrafts and the hand sewing of the roses. So this has been an amazing experience for us as we continue to look at how we can reduce fashion waste, and also just how we can create further awareness, you know, as to what we can do with the clothes that we already have in our wardrobes and furthering their life cycle.
My name is Nanaima Dondo. I'm a multidisciplinary fashion creative and owner of an independent fashion label called House of Stone. I started House of Stone in 2014 when I relocated back home. And I think upon my return, I realized that the fashion social ecosystem here was its own universe altogether, unlike anything that I'd ever experienced. I think the socio-economical challenges that I faced and still face really caused me to rethink everything in terms of like what it was that I wanted to contribute and how I wanted to work within fashion. Being a sustainable designer for me wasn't necessarily a part of my plan. I think the environment sort of forced me into a space where I had to really reconsider my design processes and my business structures. And for me, as an independent designer that's fully funding my own fashion business, it really didn't serve me to be wasteful in the way that I produced my garments. So between 2016 and 2017, I took a hiatus because I wanted to really sit back and rethink what it was that I wanted to contribute to society through fashion. When I did return, I came back in 2018 with a collection entitled Ode to Toscana. It was pivotal in defining me as a fashion creative and what it was that I wanted to contribute. I realized that I really wanted to tell what I believe to be impactful Zimbabwean stories infused with subtle cultural heritage influences and elements. This collection garnered a lot of like positive response, especially from the females. And then I realized in all of that, that my calling was literally to use fashion as a vehicle to narrate stories that in a sense ministered to people. Fashion can speak to our well-being as people, as the creator, as well as the wearer. So I'm so excited to be working on this collaborative project with Tendai Angela and being able to like have a conversation about sustainability, wellness, and how fashion fits into all of that.
Hi, so I'm Coco. Started Coco Seed in 2009, purely as a fashion house, just creating my own lines and stuff, and I was doing it by myself. I had one tailor. I came back to Zim, I was doing this in South Africa, I came back to Zim in 2011. I discovered, being here, that I struggled to find tailors or a group of people to actually produce my stuff, same quality all the time. So I realized there was a gap in the market for designers to actually have someone produce their things in quantity and in consistent quality. In the value chain, in this fashion value chain, where I was sitting was very important, and it was a gap I actually realized from across Africa. No one else was trying to do CMT. Everyone is just designing, but then no one is actually producing. I took on the challenge to do the nice stuff because of the story and the nice passion, and it was just a no-brainer. But I think we worked so well together. It opened me up to an avant-garde kind of world, which I was not in. I'm a very ready-to-wear kind of girl, so that was a fantastic collaboration. It's so fulfilling, even for the team, that we're doing this. It's not for money, it's not for anyone. It's actually just, it's waste management and it's also sustainability. So it was very enriching, I think, for myself and the team.
My name is Tendai Angela, and I am a yoga teacher or yoga instructor, and I love well-being, but well-being from a sense that it starts from you and building from your sense of self, having your self-worth. You're able to provide more and have more quality and more value for others. So I take pride in teaching yoga and bringing in the different elements of styles and history and myths and legends, and understanding the philosophy behind it, but also the science of it as well. Lanai herself is a person that embodies holisticism. When she walks into a room, you can feel her presence, and it's a feeling of gravitas and substance, and of somebody that is able to produce value. You can see that in her work, which is House of Stone. You can see the care that goes into her clothes.
well-being and, let's even say, the fashion industry or fashion, I don't think that they can be separated, because we all wear clothes, and just the same way that we can all hold principles, we all wear those principles on us. You can see that that is a complete ecosystem of how you as a person and as yourself live your life. It is about how you are able to interact with a person, how you are able to hold on to your softness. So when it does come into me as a consumer and dealing with well-being and fashion, I take care in understanding who made my clothes and where's the sustainability of it. Is there transparency within the supply chain?
My name is Gudnus Karani. I grew up in a family that plays mirror, almost everybody. And as a family thing, I really take pride in it. I was told that mirror is part of us, as an African person. It's part of who we are. We can't separate music from ourselves. As much as we can separate music from ourselves, this is as much as I can separate mirror from myself. Yeah. And I really take pride in it because it represents many aspects of our lives in Africa. Be it a sad ceremony, you might take it as a funeral, we use mirror. Be it a happy ceremony, a wedding, we use mirror.
My name is Julian Tamuka, and I am the head of design for Guyleluya. Fashion Revolution kind of came across our path serendipitously in that we were doing something that has a lot of similar motivations, in the sense that the pursuit of a more sustainable commercial enterprise, in this case clothing, and how to go about doing that. I want it to be the sort of place that allows the consumer of clothing to feel as though they have somewhere where they can go, where people have thought through the process of how best to produce this in a way that is least costly, not just in terms of the commerce or the finance, but more importantly, what it means to the ecology and the environment we live within, and how better to influence that.
My name is Halima. I am a cultural curator at Tunguo Apotheca, and I'm also managing director of Tamba Africa Circus. I first started collaborating with Fash Reb Zim a couple of years ago on different projects working in art direction, and I've built a relationship with them which has now led us to this open studio, which I'm very excited about because I get to bring in something that's of great importance to me but also to the community, which is working with young people in and around Harare, coming from marginalized or disenfranchised communities. And Tamba Africa Circus is a social circus, and we communicate important social issues affecting these young people. And at the moment we have a minor troupe in the major troupe called Nyaka Sikana. It's an all-female troupe of performers, and what we are doing with Nyaka Sikana is identifying social issues which affect young women and girls, particularly those with disability, those that are living in the ghetto, those living in very, very impoverished communities, and trying to communicate all of the different dimensions of one social issue that impacts all of these groups of young people. So working with Guyleluya and Julian has been an amazing experience for us, because we were trying to communicate climate change and how young people are contributing to the effects of climate change, and trying to bring it to a more basic level where we can communicate it in such a way that they can understand, but also be proactive about how they can change the situation in terms of environmental degradation, or how they are contributing to the effects of climate change. And with this open studio, we are quite happy to present a performance called Influencer, trying to take the idea of influencing people in a trend that's more sustainable and that's more healthy for the environment. And we are finding that it resonates well with young girls because they understand the fashion industry, but from a very one-dimensional point of view. They are beginning to see how they are part of not only the cause and effect, but also the change that they can make through the arts to communicate climate change to young people across the country.
Working with the kids from Emerald Hill was a very challenging experience. I had to learn how to quickly come outside of myself, remove my biases, and figure out how to understand what they were saying as kids who most of them are hearing impaired, and those ideas that they're translating across, and how to make sense of that. So it was interesting because you would see them use gestures and things like that. So it was a very interesting thing to see and try to make out what certain gestures kind of felt and looked like as clothing. I decided to splice and invert them so that I could come up with new garments from the same thing and appeal to the performing nature of the students.
But I think the most important thing is, are you changing someone's life? Are you working? Are you pushing? Are you moving? You know, and that's what we're trying to do.
I feel like everything about House of Stone that makes it great are the people that I connect with, that I collaborate with, that give so much to what I'm doing that makes it manifest into something that is actually bigger than House of Stone.
El Hércules, antigua textilera, y hoy vamos a hacer un recorrido para ingresar al taller de cara larga. Acompáñenme. Hemos llegado al taller de cara larga, aquí es donde se producen todas las piezas de principio a fin. Adelante. También es parte de nuestro showroom, es la primera parte del taller, es el showroom. Tienda, venta directa al público. Aquí estamos en la primer área de producción de las piezas de pared. Les presento a... Hola.
Hola. Mi nombre es Paz, ¿no? Y bueno, aquí estamos trabajando
en una pieza tríptico de técnica mixta doble para una clienta en San Miguel de Allende. Aquí está nuestra artesana maestra.
Choco, trabajando en un formato grande para nuestro taller.
Aquí están ahorita las chicas en la capacitación de la nueva colección impartida por Laura en este momento.
Hola.
Fabi.
Hola.
Araceli.
Marvila.
Esta es una área también en donde se empacan. Se preparan las piezas de gran formato para empacarse. Las cubrimos para que viajen seguras con papel
con papel craft, nuestros hilos los cubrimos con papel craft para que no se despeinen. Ya tenemos un pedido de un cliente en el extranjero. Una pieza de gran formato que nos emociona mucho porque es la primera que será en doble, digamos. Esta es la primera parte de la pieza que está lista y en la pared ahorita les mostramos. Su complemento de esta pieza, y hoy es un día importante porque se unirán. Esta pieza es un apocalipsis de mediano formato. Está trenzada en una sola pieza, cada trenza se adhiere a una madera de una pieza de MDF, continúa y cae el hilo, ¿no? Esta pieza afortunadamente viajará a Suiza, una parte de México, de Cara Larga, taller en Hércules, se va a Suiza. Ahora vamos al área de logística y empaque. Aquí pueden ver esta pieza que está recién empacada con todo el cuidado y dedicación que toman nuestros compañeros de empaque y logística para que la pieza vaya cuidada y llegue al cliente con una apariencia perfecta.
Hola, soy Pepe.
Hola, soy Anita.
Anita está preparando una caja aquí para enviar un nuevo producto de Cara Larga.
Esta es el área de administración, comunicación y ventas.
Hola, soy Patti y estoy encargada de la administración.
Hola, soy Lola y estoy a cargo de comunicación.
Hola, soy Iris, me encargo de ventas.
Aquí está el área de diseño, que en este momento no se encuentra Eli. Mesa de trabajo y entrega de material. Control de calidad. El escritorio de Ariadna. Aquí tenemos el proyecto Ensamble Artesano. Está compuesto de todos estos hermosos modelos de canasta que se hacen en la comunidad La Esperanza, por 13 mujeres que nos regalan su tiempo, su trabajo con sus manos y alegría. Son unas señoras muy alegres que próximamente les presentaremos. Aquí está el área de desarrollo de prendas, corte, confección y, bueno, también patronaje, ¿no? Aquí.
Hola, mi nombre es Matilde, estoy en el área de costura de Cara Larga y ahorita estoy confeccionando una blusa.
Gracias, Matilde. Esto es también mesa de entrega de producto y armado de piezas. Aquí están las tres piezas que posteriormente conformarán esta bolsa o esta. Aquí tenemos la mesa donde patronaje y también que sirve de apoyo para corte y confección. Y aquí les presentamos a...
Hola, buenos días, soy Yasmín. Estoy como colaboradora en lo que viene siendo diseño de ropa y elaboración de las artesanías.
Y Columba.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Buenos días, soy Columba, también soy miembro activo de Cara Larga y pues ahorita estoy elaborando una bolsita muy coquetona, monederito, por si quieren ir al antro, quieren ir a salir nada más con su identificación, su tarjeta, su dinero, la guardan y ya pueden salir a trabajar. Es un monederito muy coquetito y estoy en el área de tejido, de diseño y elaboración de tejido.
Gracias, gracias, Columba, gracias. La parte que ven atrás es parte de bodega, donde almacenamos nuestro material que utilizamos en la producción. Telas, restos de tela, de restos de algodón, la fibra sansevieria, que es también muy importante en la producción de nuestro de nuestros productos. Esta fibra proviene de Campeche. La obtenemos a través de la organización, Taller Maya, que trabaja con artesanos en esa zona y nos brinda la oportunidad de tener esta hermosura de fibra con nosotros. Aquí pueden ver también restos de sobras, más bien de la producción de grandes formatos de hilo que se utiliza para la producción de joyería, algunas partes también para decoración. Y todos estos tambos están llenos de restos, sobras de material a las que les damos una doble vida. Buscamos darles una doble vida, un doble uso. Ahora nos dirigiremos a la carpintería, a conocer a nuestra carpintería, a presentarles a la carpintera Alejandra Morales y a los herreros que trabajan para Cara Larga. Hola, Ale.
Aquí estamos laborando los proyectos que son de Cara Larga, un nuevo proyecto, mega proyecto, que consiste en este momento en un apocalipsis, que es un megaformato de 2 metros 40 centímetros. Es todo un reto porque va a estar enorme el trabajo. Básicamente es lo que estamos laborando ahorita aquí para Larga.
Gracias, Ale. Estamos en el taller de herrería Hércules. Les presento a Jesús. Hola, Jesús.
¿Qué tal? Yo soy Jesús. Ahora estamos realizando cortes para las bases de arcoíris.
Gracias, Jesús. Gracias, hasta luego. Ahora estamos de regreso en el estudio con Soko y Ana, que nos dirán unas palabras.
Hola, mi nombre es Soko, maestra artesana. Tenemos aproximadamente 8 años trabajando ya aquí en el taller de Cara Larga y es un gusto que nos visiten.
Hola, soy Ana Holschneider, cofundadora en Cara Larga y estoy aquí en la parte creativa. Estoy muy contenta de que podamos abrir las puertas y puedan conocer el taller y un poco de lo que hacemos y cómo trabajamos. Muchas gracias por invitarnos y por escuchar.
Hi everybody, I am Catherine. I'm the founder of Winsome Goods, a modern, ethical and sustainable clothing brand based in Minneapolis. I'm here in our very quiet, very empty studio right now that I'm going to show you around a little bit. But Winsome is a clothing brand and we sort of have 3 tiers to our business. There is the modern sustainable clothing component. We design and create all of our clothing in our studio and so it's all sewn by a small team of people. We also have a series of workshops that take place in our studio. Of course, those are on a bit of a hiatus right now with quarantine. But then the third component is one of my one of the more exciting projects to me, and that's the zero waste project. So we actually save 100% of the cutaway scrap in our studio. So whether it's scrap produced in production, or it's garments that have accidentally become damaged, we repurpose all that textile into other products. So we make rugs, so either area rugs and welcome mats, and we're starting to explore with other products as well, even including clothing. So I'm going to show you around our little studio space and actually give you a little bit of a rundown on how the cutting process works and how we generate all that scrap. Okay, so here is our very beautiful, very empty store space. In normal times, it was really nice to have the doors open and to have customers in. But it's still where we're keeping all of our product. So when online orders come in, we'll come out here and grab something and ship it away to you. But we have a collection of several different garments. So we have about 16 styles currently that are all available in different fabrics and different colors. So an example here actually is the Koval dress. So this is a garment where we design it in silk here, you can see it in the blue, and then also in the linen fabric here. We work with primarily natural fabrics, so cottons, linens, silks, things of that nature. And then we work with a limited amount of synthetic fabrics, but only when we source it as dead stock fabric. A lot of our garments, we really focus on versatility and like how you can wear something. So here, this Dolores jumpsuit, for example, it's a V-neck with sort of like a keyhole in back. However, you can reverse it to wear the keyhole in front with the V in back if you decided you wanted to do it that way. Okay, so today I'm going to show you a bit of the cutting process here on the cutting table and kind of take you step by step through what it looks like to cut a pattern out and how we produce the scrap that's then used in our zero project. So here is a big bolt of 100% cotton twill fabric. We use this in the modern collection, but right now we're actually using it to make face masks. So the pattern that I'm going to show you right now is for the cotton sewn face mask. This is the fitted style. And here's our pattern piece. So when I'm cutting many of something, so hundreds of something, I want to do what's called batch cutting. So I want to do it all at once. So what I would do is I would take this fabric and I would measure off, let's say it's 1 yard sections, and stack them all together, which is how I got to these pieces. So I had laid out 16 panels of fabric together. And then I'll go through and I'll chalk off the pattern. So here's the large pattern piece for the fitted mask. I chalked it off. So there I have a line to sort of cut along. So I would chalk that on the top layer of several layers, but for now you can just see it on the one layer. Here are a few cutting tools that we usually use in our process. The little handheld rotary cutter is something that I would use if I was just going to cut one of something. I don't need to plug it in, it's not electric, it's really easy to just grab this and use it. But if I'm going to cut hundreds of something, that gets really challenging to use and really exhausting and time consuming. This little red rotary cutter is nice, it's pretty nimble. This is electric, so this is something that I would use if I was going to cut a few of something, or if I was cutting something really heavy that was challenging to use with a rotary cutter. And then this is the really heavy duty, kind of scary rotary cutter. So this is one that I can cut up to maybe 30 layers of a twill fabric with. That's what I use to cut these bundles here that you see. So this cut through 16 layers of fabric, no problem. So once I have cut out my pieces here, you can see them all bundled together, but this was one layer that I had cut at one time. And that's a really quick way to get a few, I think that's like 100 masks there, ready to go. So something that I think goes unconsidered as a consumer, and I certainly even struggle to think about it from time to time when I'm purchasing a garment, but when a garment is cut out of fabric like this, there is what's called cutaway scrap. And so cutting those masks produces a pile of textile here that historically has become garbage. I'm really excited that we partnered with the University of Minnesota to come up with a solution for us to reuse this scrap so that we can use it in our new Zero collection. They developed a technique for stitching together small scraps of fabric to create somewhat of a new textile. It's almost like a felted heavy textile itself. So from here, what we would do is cut all this scrap down further into smaller pieces and use a technique in order to create a new textile of sorts made out of those fabric scraps. So here's an example of something. This is an area rug from our Zero collection. This rug is made from lots of our blue fabric. So it's many denims, it's some navies. It's primarily cotton, though there might be some tencels and synthetics mixed in here as well. Obviously, there's a lot of stitching that goes into this. So the manual labor involved in this rug is pretty intense. I think a rug like this takes something like 25 hours and saves almost 14 pounds of fabric waste. So that's a project here in our studio that I'm pretty excited about. And it's a little messy back here, but I can show you where all of our scrap is kept. So when we go through and we cut a style out, we'll bring the fabric back here and sort of color coordinate it. So then when we go to actually make a rug or make a product, we can come back here and sort of create the palettes that we want to from the scrap that's available. And then I just want to show you a little bit of the rest of the studio right now. It's a bit of a mess. It's a little hectic. We certainly haven't been working in here as a team as of late. There's Bibi. Hi, Bibi. here's our face mask, a shipping station currently, and then our little relaxation area back here. I truly cannot wait to have our team of people back again and to be able to use the space in a major way. And there up front you can see our store space. So that's where Hazel and Rose exists, as well as our little storefront for Winsome Goods. And then actually over here is where Al's Tailoring lives. So in a normal world, Al's Tailoring was here doing open tailoring on weekends, and I really hope that we can return to that sometime. So thanks for watching. I hope that you're staying safe and well and enjoying a little bit of relaxation time from home. Bye.
Biggish prints. This is the pattern of the bow tie. We join it. The reason we cannot cut the whole length is also because of the same issue of patterns. So this is the pattern of half the bow tie. I have laid it here. I want to keep that in the head, in the tip of the bow tie. Now, if I pick it here, in the entire of this, I'm not going to get it again. In the whole of this width you are seeing. Why? See how long it is? It's 21 inches. The next pattern is, if I cut it out here, the next pattern is here, too near, too short. I want to get this red again. This red is green, it's not red, so I can't put a red head and a green head.
My name is Lorna Mutejechi. I am the founder and fashion designer of Miss China Inc., which is an ethical luxury fashion line. It is basically about connecting people on either side. The people who are making the clothing with the people who are wearing it. Thank you.
So Winnie, I can see you're done with the jewelry.
Yes.
How many sets did you do?
I made 2 sets, and 3 for the adults and 1 for the kids.
Ah, okay. Is it challenging making them?
Yeah, kind of. It is challenging. You know, wrapping, it takes some time, yet you have to do it work. It's kind of challenging what I love about it.
Oh, they look nice.
Thank you.
I can see they are matching.
Yeah.
Thank you. They look lovely. They look lovely on the clothes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Winnie.
You're welcome. Challenging. You know, wrapping, it takes some time, yet you have to do it work. It's kind of challenging, but I love it.
But they look nice.
Thank you.
I can see they are matching.
Yeah.
Thank you. They look lovely. They look lovely on the clothes.
Thank you.
Thank you, Winnie.
You're
Stephanie Benedetto, and I'm the Queen of Raw.
Our online platform brings innovative fabrics and sustainable raw materials to the global supply chain across industries. My family has been in the textiles business for over 100 years. In 1896, my great-grandfather arrived in New York by ship from Austria and landed at Ellis Island. So textiles and fashion are in my blood. Fashion, the planet, and for my 3-year-old son, I'm tackling this problem head on.
Hi, I'm Bridget Ortiz, and I'm owner, author, and designer of Born Again Vintage. And today we're at Born Again Vintage, the Collective in Montclair, New Jersey. And today I'm going to show you how to upcycle a sweater skirt. Brianna's wearing a dress, which used to be a sweater skirt. And all you have to do is find a match for the top of your sweater skirt. I chose this shirt. And you got to make sure that the dress or the top that you're cutting to add with the sweater skirt has Lycra or stretch knit jersey so it can stretch into the bottom fabric. So this is the top that I chose, and I cut it exactly where I wanted it to be. So you have to determine for yourself where you want the dress to fall. And then once you cut it, you put the two pieces together with a straight stitch, and you have this wonderful dress from a sweater skirt. If you want more information, you can find me on Born Again Vintage, the Collective at Facebook. Thanks.
This is where we start everything. This is called our picking table. So when a dirty fleece comes in, we spread it out on this table, and we're basically looking for the quality of the fiber. So we'll make notes on how dirty the fiber is, whether it is strong or whether it has breaks in it, how the crimp structure is, how the lock structure is, and basically how we think this fiber will be processed. Once we've evaluated the fiber, then we're going to go and wash it. That's the next step. We just use basic laundry type bags, and for washing wool, we use really hot water. The hot water is used to basically melt away the lanolin, which is the greasy substance that sheep produce to protect their skin and protect their fiber. So we do a three wash system. The first wash is with a biodegradable citrus-based soap and very hot water, and then we'll do two other rinses basically after that. In our mill, and actually in most mills across North America, the scouring or the washing of the wool is the biggest bottleneck. Because of the hot water that's necessary, it takes the longest amount of time to actually wash the fiber. After we've washed it, we dry it. We just put it on these racks, and we just put a fan on it, and it takes anywhere from 10 to 12 hours to dry. And the fiber needs to be fully dry before you can process it further. So usually we're washing and then processing the next day, depending on, you know, what colors or whatever we're doing. So after we've washed and dried, the next step is the picker. Come over this way. So this is what some fiber looks like after it's been picked, or after it's been washed but not picked. So what the picker does, it's essentially opening up the fiber to prepare it for processing. That's what this machine does. I'm gonna put some on the belt here and let you see what happens. My kids call this machine the cotton candy machine, because once it's been picked, it gets blown into the picker room and swirls around like cotton candy. So I'm gonna turn it on.
Thank you.
So once the fiber has been picked and it's all in that room, we lightly spray it with a conditioner. The conditioner is to help the fibers stick together during the rest of the processing. Humidity and static are our biggest challenges in terms of dealing with fiber in the mill. If there's too much humidity, because wool is this amazing fiber, it soaks up ambient moisture and then releases it later in drier conditions. So we need the fiber to be humid, but we don't need it to be too humid. Static is bad, too much humidity is bad, so the conditioner helps us kind of control those variables. So once it's come out of the picker, it looks like this. So you can see how it's more opened up and it's ready to be processed. So every fiber responds differently based on the crimp. So the little wavies, the picture 80s hair crimp, and the fiber diameter and all these other factors. So just based on our experience, we know how we want to process each fiber. So we'll weigh it out based on what fiber it is that we're processing it. And we put it onto the next machine, which is called the Carter. This is really the heart of the mill. This is the machine that we want running all day long. And this is essentially combing the fibers all in the same direction. So we load them up on this belt based on all those factors, and then I'm gonna turn it on. You can see it work. Are it probably came out in a bat format, and that's actually this big drum down here. So we can load fiber up on this drum and it spins around and makes a bat of wool. If we're making yarn, which is what we're doing today, we have it come out like this. This is called roving. So these machines are pretty incredible. They have measuring timers on them, so we can set how many meters we want per barrel. And it'll go and then buzz or shut off when we've got that amount that we want. So when we have our roving, the next step for spinning it is to make it more even. So that's when we come over to this machine. This machine is called the draw frame, and it's essentially making a more consistent and even fiber or roving. So we've got our cans back here. We're running two at a time in this batch, but we could run three or four at a time, depending. And it basically just spreads the fibers out, combines them, and makes them even. To have the most even yarn that you could get at the end of the day requires the most even and consistent roving. So we will run all the roving through here twice. So we'll do one pass, and then we'll do a second pass. So the next step after we have run it through the draw frame is the spinner. So this is a 12 spindle spinner. These are called bobbins, and they go along the bottom. For those that have never involve themselves in any fiber arts, basically we've got our roving, and the way that we make yarn is two basic steps: drafting, which is thinning it out so you can have the thinner thickness that you want, and then adding twist. If I pull it apart, it comes apart easy, but if I pull it apart and I add some twist, it becomes a really firm structure. So that's essentially what this machine does. The back roller and the front roller spin at different speeds based on what we're making, and the spindles spin as well. So all of those things are functioning at the same time. So if you can see, we've got the roving coming up the back and through the front. The draft is controlled by this back roller, and the twists per inch is controlled by the front roller. So I'm going to turn it on and you can see the magic. So if you come in here, you can see right here, this is where all the twist is happening. We can't have one doing, you know, a thick yarn and one doing a thin yarn. But that is how we control it. So we can run a large chunky yarn on here the same way that we would run a thin yarn. We just are changing the settings. So after we have run, after the fiber has gone through on the spinner, we're left with bobbins full of what are called singles. So this is a single ply. It's just one strand of yarn that's been spun. And you know, a single ply yarn is something that people use that it, you can knit with or weave with. But more often than not, we're going to actually ply it. So we'll take our singles over to here to this machine. This is called our plier. So, a three ply, which is what I'm doing here, is a perfectly balanced yarn. But you could do a two ply, you could do a four ply, you could do a 12 ply, whatever you want. But essentially we're taking the singles, we're turning the twist the opposite direction. So we're taking out just a bit of twist and they're coming together to form a plied yarn. I don't know if the light is okay, if you can see that. So we'll show you how that one works. Once the yarn has been plied, we're almost done. We bring it over here and we basically take the bobbins and we wind them onto cones. The cones are an easier format for all the next steps. This machine will just wind them onto these cones. And then we put the cones on this machine. This is called our steamer. So when you have applied yarn, there's still a little pent up energy or twist in that yarn, and so you have to set the twist, and to do that we blast it with a really hot steam. These chambers fill up with very hot water and the fiber goes, or the yarn goes through there, and that is what sets the twist. And then it goes up these long chambers, and this is just hot air, that's just to dry it, and then it comes back down here and winds back onto a cone. And that process is what sets the twist. So basically at this stage, after it's been steamed, it's finished yarn, it's ready to go. And we do occasionally sell yarn on a cone, but more often than not, people want yarn in a skein. So we have a skein winder in the basement of our house. This might be the world's smallest mill. We can fit almost every machine in here except for our skein winder. So in our house we have a skein winder and it takes the yarn off of cones and puts it into a skein. If you are a knitter or a crocheter or whatever, you've probably seen this. And this is the format that yarn is most often sold in stores. So there we have our skein. So oftentimes that is where, that's the end of the line for yarn. We've processed it, we've steamed it, we've set the twist, and we've put it in a skein. Now, if we want to add color, that's when we bring it back into the mill. So we process a lot of naturally colored fibers. So this is the natural shade of the sheep. This is the natural shade of an alpaca. But more often than not, fiber on sheep is white. So then we do some dyeing. We do all our own dyeing in-house, and we do only natural dyeing. So we don't use any synthetic dyes. We just use minerals, plants, bugs, and most of that, I'd say about 60%, we grow or forage ourselves on the farm. So I'm not going to go into natural dyeing a lot, but this is where we do it. We do it in large pots. Some of our dyes. We grew Dyer's coreopsis. That's a really popular one. Does a lovely orange. This is some goldenrod that we foraged in our on our property. That does a lovely yellow. And then one of the things that I'm most excited about is last year we actually grew our own Japanese indigo. I don't know if you can see it. Japanese indigo is one of only two sources of a natural blue, and then we obviously processed it and turned it into a pigment that we can then use to dye with and dye blue colors. So just an example, we've got logwood and cochineal, which are two dyes we can't grow here. It's a hard-shelled beetle that grows on cacti and a tree that grows in tropical climates. But yeah, so then we do all our dyeing here, and then when it's all done, we will skin it and label it and sell it.
Hi, I'm Kat Houston, co-founder of Houston Textile, and this is your virtual tour of our facility. We are a small batch textile manufacturing mill near Sacramento, California. Outside of our warehouse, we have a demo dye garden to showcase soil health, natural dyes, and fibers, such as naturally colored cotton and indigo. Our process begins with yarn, which we get from domestic spinners, farmers, and ranchers of the raw products. In this video, you can see Ryan warping an array of different fabrics, from a beautiful sulfur dyed denim, a triple dip dyed botanical denim, and a wonderful natural canvas. During the warping process, each yarn goes through a drop wire, a counter, a condensing reed, and then finally to the pinless dressing reel, similar to a modern sectional warper. The pinless dressing reel made by Davis and Ferber can hold up to 2,000 yards of yarn for a chambray-like fabric. Once all of the yarn is on the pinless dressing reel, we transfer it to a loom beam. The transfer places the yarn on the beam as a single sheet of yarn. If you're familiar with sewing, this process is similar to winding the bobbin of a sewing machine. The big difference is we use thousands of ends of yarn on our big bobbin. From here, we move the beam to our loom. Here you see a Draper X3 loom from the 1960s. This is where you get to see the real gratification of weaving. We start by getting the new warp on the loom. If we are using the same construction as the previous project, we can tie the old and new warp together either by hand or by machine. If the projects are of different construction, we dress the loom to its new construction. No matter the construction, each yarn thread will go through a drop wire. The drop wire will stop the loom as the wire falls if a yarn breaks. Next, they go through a heddle on the harness. The harness and how they are threaded determine the pattern of the fabric woven. After that, the yarn goes through a reed, which goes back and forth, allowing the shuttle to pass through the alternating warp thread to make the fabric. An important step to remember is winding our bobbins. Some of our looms have a unifill bobbin winder built into the loom, while others have a battery which you placed filled bobbins in. For filling these bobbins with yarn, we use our Witten bobbin winder from the late 1940s. We have to keep the bobbin battery loaded as the loom will automatically eject an empty bobbin and replace it with a filled bobbin. This will keep the weaving process going smoothly. Here you will see Ryan filling the battery of our Draper X3 loom. We mostly work with cotton and wool, and as bast fibers, flax and hemp specifically, gain a stronger supply network in the United States, we are hoping to be at the forefront of using these domestic fibers and regenerative processes for our ongoing productions. Here you can see some wool twills, chambrays, denim, and canvas that we have made over the years, as well as some garments that have been made in-house for showing what can be done with our fabric. We proudly show off some of the items that are available to purchase through various shops and designers who use our fabrics. We have a passion for craftsmanship and fabrics with natural and sustainable materials. This goes beyond just how the fiber is grown, but also any potential dyes that will be used, as well as continual focus on ethical working and environmental conditions for animals and humans in our productions. Mission-driven, we offer support to local and domestic farmers and ranchers by working with their fiber here domestically through our current and expanding offerings. We hope this leads to more valued American products, producers, and processes for us to showcase in rebuilding our great natural textile traditions and regional resilience.
What's up, everybody? How's it going? I'm Patrick. We are at the Nisolo factory in Peru to give you a feel for kind of out here in the street. This is what it looks like. Huge mountains over there. The Andes are in the distance. It's a little cloudy, so you can barely see them. But this is the street outside the factory. And we're gonna do a little tour. So, here we go. That's Clark Brewer. He's here with us this week taking some photos.
What's up, guys? So excited for you to see this place. It's amazing.
All right, let's go in. So, these are the factory doors outside. And yeah, we're gonna try to meet some people and stay tuned toward the end. We're gonna do an interview with a couple people and our impact associate and a few shoemakers. Hello, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo estás? This is Frank. Frank's our general manager at the factory.
Hi guys, how are you? Welcome to Creatra. Bienvenidos a Creatra.
Perfecto. And this is the admin building where most administration is and finance and planning and all that sort of stuff. These are the factory doors. And then in here is where we store all the leathers. These are boxes that are about to head to the States, where all the leather is stored in here. Hola, my nene, ¿qué tal? And then now we're gonna go to the factory floor. All right, here we go, the fun stuff. Yeah, and if you wanna ask questions during the tour, I'll try to answer them as I see them. But yeah, these are lockers for everybody. Here's a big view of the place. We're gonna walk through each section to give a little more explanation of how the shoe process works. But first, what I'm most excited about, one of the things is a soccer field inside the factory. When we decided we wanted to build a dream factory, this was one of the things we wanted to do, was a soccer field. So right here, right next to the factory that everybody plays in regularly. So this is the cutting section where, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo estás? Where the first step in the leather making process is cutting shoes. Hola, ¿qué tal? Buenas. And then back here, hola Carmen, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo están? ¿Qué tal? This is where we stamp the soles and make the insoles of the shoes. And then let me back up here. ¿Qué tal? We're gonna go next to where the soles are actually made, which is right here. This is called prefinitos, which is like kind of like pre-finishing, but it's more just where soles are made. It's really loud in here. But this is the, let's see here. ¿Qué tal? Buenas. ¿Cómo están? This is where travel derbies, this is what they look like before we actually put them on shoes. ¿Qué tal? Buenas. And now we're gonna go to sewing, because after you cut the leather, ¿qué tal? Mira, ¿quién tenemos? This is William, first shoemaker that I ever met, and Matt, our impact associate. ¿Cómo están? Buenas, buenas. Here's where we're tracking all day, every day, at what hour, how many shoes have we made, that sort of thing. And then this is the sewing section. ¿Qué tal? Buenas. ¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes. ¿Cómo están? Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo están? This is one of the hardest skills you have to have, is the ability to sew. ¿Qué tal? Buenas tardes. ¿Qué tal? Pampilo, ¿qué pasó? ¿Dónde está Pampilo? ¿Todavía? ¿Qué tal? Buenas. Buenas tardes. ¿Cómo están? All right, let's see. Questions. Are we seeing? How many employees do we have? We have 120 here in the factory. And hello. Yamila, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo estás? 120, about 25 admin, and close to 100 shoemakers. Fiorella, ¿qué tal? And all right, now we're moving into the lasting section. Jeffrey, ¿cómo estás? Jeffrey's a dad. He just had his first baby 10 days ago. ¿Qué tal? Buenas. Hi, Elvin. Fernando, ¿cómo estás? Some of the lasting is still done by hand, which is kind of part of what they're doing here. And then some of it is done through a lasting machine. Let's see Fernando do that. A ver, sí. A ver, Fernando. ¿Se puede hacer? So it basically fits the shoe to the last and gives a good fit for it. Whoa. Okay, let's walk back here. So here are all the guys from lasting. They're the most fun. ¿Qué tal? ¿Cómo están? Buenas. Figaro. ¿Qué tal? ¿Cuándo vamos a jugar fulbito? When play soccer? ¿Cuándo vamos a jugar? All right, yeah. Now we're gonna move over to finishing. Let's see, any questions that have come through? Oh, what's up, Reed? Got some... Only one question? Come on, people. What do you want to know? Send us some questions. Hola. So, this is finishing. Primarily, stereotypically, women do this role because they pay way more attention to detail and are amazing at noticing anything that's wrong whatsoever with the shoe and ensuring that everything is done perfectly. And then if there are any issues with them, they go over here to kind of be reworked. And then in the back over there, ¿qué tal, buenas? That's where we are, that's where we pack all the shoes before we send them off to you guys. Ah, yeah, mira. So we got a bag coming. Okay. So, Sedona Derby's coming your way soon. We got chukkas. That's a new color for the fall that's coming in. That's really awesome. And then only one more place I want to show. Can't do it all today, but this is another section where when we're doing all the Huarache sandals, we create a second line of production in here. Because the process is a bit different than it's very handmade, and so we do it a little bit differently. Buenas, ¿cómo están? And then in here is the cafeteria. Whoa, almost ate it. ¿Qué tal, buenas? This is the cafeteria where everybody eats, and also we have trainings and things like that. Okay, so that's pretty much it.
Teresa Williams.
And I'm Karina Williams. We're clearly sisters, and we're the co-founders of Celsius, a premium sustainable garment care provider and Brooklyn's first eco-friendly laundromat.
So right now we are on our back patio, but you're gonna get to see our sustainable laundry business in just a moment.
Just a little bit of background on why Celsius actually exists. When I first moved to New York in 2012, I was working in fashion and I had a number of pieces that I really wanted expertly taken care of in order for them to live a really long life. And what I found was that most laundromats and then garment care providers in the city were really not conducive to that mission. They were dingy places with outdated equipment that really wasn't there to get my laundry clean. And that's when I started dreaming of my ideal laundromat. And I got Teresa, who was living in London at the time, on board and got her to move to New York. And fast forward, we're sitting here in the backyard of our laundromat.
So we envisioned a beautiful, modern, light-filled space that wasn't only sparkling clean, but also environmentally friendly, and that was one of the values that our mom instilled in us from a really young age. She actually built our childhood home from sustainably sourced materials, and she did that pre-internet age. So that was a really inspiring example when we built Celsius. So we found the perfect space in Williamsburg, Brooklyn, with really tall storefronts and lots of natural light. And then I sourced a lot of the furnishings and also some of the building materials secondhand from places like Craigslist, auctions, big reuse. For example, the cork wall up there actually is a material that was already in the space. That was the flooring before we moved in here. And it was really important for us that the build-out was done thoughtfully and that we were able to reuse and upcycle a lot of the material.
So there are a number of things that actually make our laundromat sustainable. Number one, we work with the most energy efficient equipment there is. Our washers are super smart. They save about 30% in water versus standard laundromat equipment. And then our dryers have sensors, so they will also save about 30% in gas with each dry. We have a non-toxic biodegradable detergent that we work with in-house and that actually gets delivered to us in reusable buckets. We ship these back to the supplier once they're empty and then they get refilled with detergent. Another one that I am personally really proud of, we have completely banned the use of chlorine bleach, conventional fabric softener, and dryer sheets at Celsius. Instead, we offer eco-friendly alternatives that will treat stains. For example, we have sodium percarbonate, which is really, really effective in getting those red wine stains out of your whites.
Then we use vinegar to soften your laundry, also to treat stains, and dryer balls are really great in getting rid of static cling. And last but not least, we have a fantastic team on site that is always there to educate anyone who comes in and wants to wash with us on the most eco-friendly yet efficient ways to get their laundry clean. And speaking of education, we also try to give as much information to our followers all across the world to be able to do their laundry as sustainably as possible. For that, we sell some of our in-house products online in our online store, Celsius.com. And we also have products from other companies that are sustainably minded. So for example, our Wonder Bar, which is an amazing vegetable soap-based stain remover, or this microfiber catching ball. We ship all of those online orders in easy to recycle packaging. And speaking of recycling, we obviously also recycle and compost in store here. And we also use TerraCycle for some of those materials that are really hard to dispose of. So this isn't actually our usual setup. We did have to pivot, create some new systems, and put some additional safety procedures in place to make sure that our team is safe. So right now we have this plant wall that puts the appropriate amount of distance between our team members and the customers. And on top of that, it's really, really nice to look at. So here at Celsius, we always care about how we make our customers feel and how our space makes our customers feel as much as we care about the garments that are brought in. And speaking of garment care, a lot of the conversation currently going on in fashion and fashion sustainability is really centered around production or manufacturing, as well as disposal of a garment or the end of life cycle, but not a lot of attention is usually given to what is known as the user phase, or what we actually here like to call the care phase. The manner in which you care for your garments can actually really determine how much waste you put out into the world, obviously in forms of textile waste, microplastics, dryer sheets, as well as toxic byproducts from synthetic conventional detergents. So there's a couple of very simple rules that we go by here at Celsius in order to wash in an eco-friendly and sustainable way. Number one is definitely know your materials and how you can care for them. Number two, use natural detergent and use a lot less than you may be used to of it. Most of the detergents, most certainly the one that we use here, is really efficient and you don't need a lot, and you certainly don't want any residue to be stuck in your clothing, as that may shorten the life cycle of it. And then ditch any synthetics in your garment care products. So steer clear of synthetic detergents, fabric softeners, and certainly dryer sheets. So I would add to that, that's really, really important that you know how to stain treat and spot treat your garments, and also how to mend them. That's really gonna allow you to keep your garments in rotation for as long as possible. Also, a great way to preserve the integrity of the fibers of your garment is to dry on a lower temperature. And if you are able to air dry some of your pieces, that's really the most sustainable way of taking care of them. So I guess in a nutshell, just take really good care of your garments, treat them like an investment, love them, keep them in rotation, and if you do need to pass them on, try to find a home for them with someone that's gonna love them as much as you love them at one point.
We really hope that you'll continue to help us broaden the conversation around the user care phase of a garment, and we also hope that you enjoyed following us around today, and definitely feel free to keep in touch online, either on our website celsius.com, or follow us on social at @celsius_social for more garment care tips.
So I'm the CEO and founder of Wearable Collections, Adam Berukowitz. We place bins inside of buildings. We collect at the New York City Green Market. Basically, we create innovative hubs of collections to make it convenient for New Yorkers to recycle their clothing. Well, on any given year, we might collect around 2 million pounds. Since our inception, we've collected nearly 20 million pounds of clothing. They can put clothing, shoes, linens, towels, accessories like handbags, hats. We try to avoid comforters and pillows just because sometimes they have down in them and they're really difficult to recycle. There is reuse from them, but unfortunately, when people are recycling like pillows and mattresses, they've usually used them so much that reuse is not the best option. We're really like a front-end collector keeping the items out of the landfill. We market, we're trying to educate people on the need to keep items out of the landfill. And we also provide the logistics to do so. After we collect it, we bring it to a sorting facility. Used clothing is treated like a commodity, so there's a market price depending on the supply and demand worldwide. And we bring it to this sorting facility that we never go through the bags, so they go through the bags and they'll sort the clothing into up to about 200 different grades of clothing, whether it's A, B, C, D, E quality, which is just, you know, A would be top quality, E might be slightly less quality goods. And, you know, there might be men's, women's, children, baby, and summer, winter. So there's a bunch of different grades that they would be looking to sort. And then they have clients all around the world, which they distribute these different categories to. Although we call it recycling, really it's the reuse of secondhand clothes that drives the economics of all of this. And the industry standard is that about 50% of the clothing can be reused as secondhand. And that's what we derive value from. And that's what kind of pays for the entire operation, is the reuse of secondhand. Now, to be efficient, those organizations, these sorting facilities, they also will find different destinations for this other items that need to be recycled. They'll send it to a shredding place that will shred the clothing and repurpose it for low-grade fiber products like carpet padding or insulation, mattress filling. But really, there's no value in it. In fact, it costs a little bit of money to get rid of those items, but there's a little bit of a arbitrage between the cost of waste. Waste, getting rid of, you know, if you're a commercial business, you actually have to pay to get rid of your waste. So maybe it's a little cheaper to shred it, and so they save money. When you're dealing with millions of pounds, you're saving a lot of money over the course of a year. And that's really where, like, my obsession has evolved, is the reuse or the recycling part of that other 50% that currently has no value, because I feel like if we can connect the dots in ways that can create more value from that, now you're turning a negative, something that's a cost right now, into a potential profit center. And I think if you do that and you align the economics, you know, there would be a lot more incentive for people to keep these clothing and textiles out of the landfill. And I think that would obviously, you know, help my business in many different ways, and also, you know, help the world, the environment at the same time. I mean, it's destroyed it. Not unlike many businesses, it's really hurt us tremendously. And I have to tell you, like, I just didn't anticipate that. I really didn't. Like, I consider myself a waste manager, and, you know, I'm very aware that waste is always generated, and that is kind of why I've gone down this line of work as an entrepreneur. We started as a project, really, to raise money for spinal cord research when one of my best friends was hit by a car. And it was really a project to raise funds and awareness for spinal cord research. But the 2007-2008 financial crisis hit, and I was doing this, and I was seeing that, you know, there was a lot of opportunity in waste management, what I thought was, like, growing sustainability mindset. And I just dug my feet, and I was like, this is what I'm going to do. For my career. And, you know, that was coming out of a crisis, a financial crisis, but there's always waste. And you know, I've even, like, I've watched what's happened with plastics when, like, America exports a lot of their, exported a lot of their plastics to China, and then China decided to ban our plastics, and then, you know, you saw the plastics recycling industry get crushed because of that. And, you know, I always thought, like, you know, I think there'll always be a demand for this clothing. I thought that it couldn't happen to the clothing industry. And so when this happened, and I knew that I would be able to collect clothes, I knew people were locked in, I knew there would be, you know, a lot of house cleaning. But what I didn't anticipate was that the people that we get rid of our clothes to, first of all, they store a lot of clothes over the winter because, you know, the spring is when they, you know, they have a lot of business. You know, they got a lot of demand in the spring. And so they store a lot, like squirrels, you know, squirreling their nuts away over the winter in preparation for the growth in demand in the spring. And so they were filled to the gills before Corona hit. And Corona hit, like, right around March. And on top of that, I never really associated, like, what we do so much with retail. Like, I knew retail was gonna be hit hard. Obviously, no people going into stores and people being frightened to be around each other. I knew that was gonna be an obvious, hit from Corona. But, like, I didn't expect, I didn't associate that all of our business really hinges on retail as well. And so if people aren't going to thrift stores, if people aren't going to markets in Central and South America or in Africa, then there's no place to move any of this clothing. And, you know, basically when it happened, I understood the slowdown, but I anticipated there would be a balance. And there really, we're sitting in September now, about 6 months from the initial lockdown, and prices are still pretty much at rock bottom. There's still a glut of inventory, and still, you know, while there's places have opened up, there's still retail is still, you know, taking a tremendous hit. And you know, it's a struggle to survive right now. So you got to figure out some pivots. First of all, everyone in the industry has to appreciate clothing for what it is. It's comprised of it's raw materials that a lot of work and a lot of effort and a lot of resources go into the development of these raw materials in the first place, whether it's cotton that, you know, utilizes a lot of water, pesticides, land use, or like the, you know, obviously you have your petroleum based products like polyester. And, you know, it's typically, it seems like fashion has been part of this race to the bottom. You know, it's cheaper goods made, you know, with cheaper labor, made less durably. And so, you know, there has to be envisioning of the types of products that people want, and a value placed on the raw materials that go into these things, and a totally different design mindset. So I'm, like, obviously on the post-consumer side, and I don't think that enough goes into the post-consumer side. What's going to happen with these items? People want to make beautiful items. People want to make things that are on trend, but how much thought has gone into the actual materials? What, you know, has gone into those materials that make those trendy items, and what's going to happen when someone's done with this, when the trend is over in 6 months or a year? And so I think a totally different focus on the types of materials, on design. You know, with that race to the bottom, there's a lot of blends that are used to keep the prices down, and those blends are incredibly difficult to reutilize, to recycle. So there's a lot of innovation on the horizon, whether it's mechanically breaking them down, you know, a lot of that mechanical stuff. You can extract value if you sort the stuff by material, but there's really no great way of, there's some innovation happening here with optical sorting in different ways. You want to do it cost effectively. So if you can get 100% cotton out of a mix, you could probably make something with that cotton. Or if you get 100% polyester, you could probably figure out what to do with it. But when it comes in all these blends, and there's really like no value placed on breaking these items down, or there's no way to do it cost effectively, then it really doesn't make sense to do it. So with a rethinking of how we're going to use materials and taking the end of life into consideration, I think tremendous progress can be made. And, you know, I'm always keeping my, you know, always trying to stay aware of what kind of innovations, like a little obsessed with innovations. And there are some companies making some tremendous progress. And I feel very optimistic that better and better solutions are popping up by the day. And I, you know, I know I'm not alone in this thinking, and I know that, like, you know, I'm optimistic that, yeah, you know, every year we're going to see dramatic improvement in the respecting the values of the materials and better design going into durability and basically the longevity of the fashion that we wear.